The entire educational world looks back now on those few professors who protested what was happening in Nazi Germany with gratitude. And I predict that someday the entire academic community of this country will look back on the few professors who have publicly protested our Vietnam policy and say they kept the spirit of truth alive. We've been talking for a long time in this meeting, and we should be beginning to turn our thoughts towards action. But there are two analytical points which I would like to make, which I think bear on the action we should take. First of all, I believe that we have to recognize that this country is not just in a foreign policy crisis, but in a constitutional crisis as well. This point has been made by the New York Times, which said editorially that a style of executive decision-making and news manipulation hitherto practiced only briefly in times of temporary emergency has now become a permanent way of life, which means, I think, that the Johnson Doctrine has two sides. It means, on the one hand, that we will not permit governments to come into being overseas that we do not like, even if they are supported by a majority of the people. But the Johnson Doctrine also means that the government will not permit the majority of the people of this country to have a responsible discussion and to determine our own policy. And I think that means that people who have been working in the Freedom Democratic Party have now to realize that it is not only Negroes in Mississippi who are unrepresented in the government of the United States, but in a situation where Congress has handed over its constitutional power to declare war and peace to the president, it is all of us who are now unrepresented by our government. And I think this means, too, that the free speech movement here and other movements on other campuses which have been concerned with university reform must now concern themselves with the unelected Board of Regents who run this country. The second analytical point I wish to make has really been made for me by this morning's newspaper. We are, I think, in a kind of pause now, where the bombing of North Vietnam has been going on long enough that even those of us who most protest it, somewhere within ourselves begin psychologically to acquiesce. Just as if a pan of toothpaste is mentioned enough times on the television, you find yourself subliminally reaching for a panel when you go to the drugstore, so somehow too bombing has become almost an accepted part of the scenery. But this situation isn't going to last. There's going to be a new crisis in this country by midsummer, I think, when tens of thousands of American ground troops are in full-scale combat in Vietnam, and we have to be prepared to deal with that crisis when it arrives. Now, Professor Scalapino said at Washington that what we are doing is simply putting in a small number of American ground troops to check the Viet Cong in its expected monsoon offensive so that by September or October, the Viet Cong will want to come to the negotiating table. As a historian, I think this is madness. 400,000 French troops failed to defeat this nationalist movement. How can we expect that 25,000, 40,000, 100,000 American troops will bring them to their knees in one summer? In other words, the troops that are going in are going to be there for a long, long time. Now, Professor Schlesinger at Washington presented himself as a supporter of this policy with a difference, with certain infinitesimal differences designed to indicate that he was a supporter of presidential candidate Robert Kennedy rather than presidential incumbent Lyndon Johnson. And I would like to remind Professor Schlesinger that in February 1962, the senator whose Secretary of State he may hope one day to be told Homer Biggert of the New York Times, quote, "The United States is in a war in Vietnam. American troops will stay till we win." That's hardly a policy of negotiation. Is there an alternative? I think the alternative is nonviolent revolution. And for the benefit of the FBI men present, I would like to make it clear that what I mean is not the violent overthrow of the United States government, but the nonviolent retirement from office of the present administration. And further, that the way to bring this about is the creation of civil disobedience so massive and so persistent that the Tuesday lunch club that is running this country, Johnson, McNamara, Bundy, and Rusk, will forthwith resign. We do not live in a parliamentary government like the British, where a vote of no confidence can compel a criminally irresponsible administration to resign, as the British compelled their administration to resign in the Suez Crisis. Yet we cannot wait till the next presidential election in 1968. And therefore, I think we have to vote with our feet by marching and picketing, vote with our hands by burning draft cards and refusing to pay income tax, and if necessary, vote with our backsides by sitting in jail. But finally, and most of all, I think that a strategy of nonviolent civil disobedience could be successful because I believe in the power of nonviolence. Thoreau said in the 1840s that one man who was prepared to die could stop slavery in the United States. And I think this weekend we should all search our hearts and our souls for the courage and the clarity of spirit to go to the White House, to go to the Oakland Terminal on June 22nd, to go to Vietnam if we could and stand in front of the flamethrowers and say, if blood must be spilt, let it be mine rather than the blood of Vietnamese children. If you need someone to search and destroy, let me save you the trouble. Here I am. And if you are worried that the natives all over the world are restless, we want you to know that the natives here at home are restless too. And maybe there should be a contingency plan to keep some of the Marines here to deal with us.